That was the day on April 26 when Singaporeans came together to tribute healthcare workers and migrant workers who were working on the front line. And you can hear this chorus of singers from this video that was published by Mediacorp. Similar tributes have been happening around the world. You may have seen them. Sometimes these tributes to healthcare workers are happening on a daily basis. And I think what this illustrates is how the pandemic has really illuminated the sacrifice that so many individuals are making in order to save lives. Now, Petrina, I want to hear from you. What was the significance of the song being sung in that video?
Hi, Laurindo. Yeah, it was interesting. I remember that day because we knew it was happening, and we also knew that where we lived, I mean, I face the opening of a highway. So I knew that we won't be able to get that feeling of community singing because there was nobody around us who we were going to hear. So we all got in the car and drove around trying to catch the singing. And it was kind of fun. Like we managed to hear, like, in our neighborhood, some people like popping their heads out and, you know, clapping and singing. And it was really interesting because whilst we were trying to bask in that moment, you know, after that online, I think there was a lot of discussion about who that was for and if it was even meaningful, right? And then now I'm reading all these rather distressing reports about how we are paying these volunteer swabbers and people who are trying to do testing so much more than our actual healthcare workers, right? And that's really the part of it that makes me kind of go, hang on a minute, there's something wrong here, right? And I think we need to take this opportunity, hopefully, to really look at what's this idea of, you know, what we've decided to sort of term essential workers and stuff like that. So yeah, that it's sort of a kind of a weird bittersweet feeling that when I see that happening, it pinches a little, I have to be honest.
We're back with another episode of Inclusively. In this series, we're talking about how the pandemic has changed people's lives and what lessons that we have learned that could make a post-pandemic world more inclusive. I'm your host, Laurindo Garcia.
And I'm Petrina Cow. Glad to be back.
So happy to be back.
Well, today's theme, as we've heard, is about health. And you know, I think all of us have had our whole lives sort of thrown into a new sort of, well, I wouldn't say disarray, but just having to adjust to new normals, right? We've been calling it. And I think whether, you know, and people, like somebody said the other day, which I thought was a wonderful sort of analogy, was like, we're all in the same storm, but we're in different boats. So, you know, everyone has their own style, I suppose, or own situations that they have to kind of overcome. Or, you know, some people are thriving, some people are not doing so well. But I think definitely because this is a pandemic, I think health is one of the biggest sectors, I would say, that has really come into the forefront, right? So for me, it's just been really basic. It's just been trying to keep healthy and fit and keep my family healthy and fit. So just trying to provide good meals for them and making sure they wake up. And, you know, I have teenagers, so this is a problem. And so it's like, can y'all just eat like regular meals, you know, stuff like that. And just like, don't stare at the gaming thing for all day. just doing that. That's my struggle. That's it. There's nothing big.
It's been so interesting. Usually in a situation like this, myself and my husband, Alan, would be the first people to go out there and volunteer or do stuff, get around, make sure people have what they need, trying to fill gaps where possible. But we find ourselves in a situation where we are sharing a home with Alan's 90-year-old mother. Well, she'll be 90 on Monday. She's got advanced dementia. And we then brought upon us a conversation where we're like, well, if we go out, it may be great, but we also then increase the risk of bringing something home to her. So given that we've all been so sensitized to what goes in and out of the house and who's there, and you really got to, you know, honor the sanctity that you have set up in your home quarantine. For us, we've just been keeping very small daily lives, just the five of us, keeping her well and trying to keep her as engaged as possible. And that's been a struggle kind of to deal with that, because then you're having to, I've been having to quiet down the other side of myself that would usually be going out and doing things and really just being, learning how to appreciate every day that we've got with Alan's mom and doing what we can remotely. So we've really learned a lot from this. But given that this episode is all about health, I think some context is really critical here. So as we've seen, you know, frontline workers, healthcare workers in the fight against COVID-19 are really working in a response that is severely under-resourced across the region. I think one good way for us to understand the resource situation is to look at where investments are. And so, Petrina, have a think about this. At one end of the scale, we have countries like Japan, Australia, New Zealand, who roughly spend about 10% of their GDP on public health. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have countries like Bangladesh, Indonesia, and Pakistan, who roughly spend about 3% on public health. And this is all according to statistics on Statista from 2017. So my question to you, Petrina, is where do you think Singapore sits on that spectrum?
If 10 being the highest and 3 being the lowest, I don't know, like 5 maybe?
Okay, so Singapore actually sits in the middle, spending around 4% of GDP on public health, sitting right next door to the Philippines and Mongolia.
Wow, it feels like it's very little, like 4% feels very little.
That's right. And I'm sure some of our guests will have an opinion on that as well as we go to speak to them. But let me give you another dimension here. So what this means with this, you know, the resources and investment is that the number of people who are able to work in the sector is also then, there are certain challenges and headwinds there. So for example, in Australia, based on statistics from WHO, there are 35 doctors per 10,000 people. Wherein on the other end of the scale, in places like Indonesia, for every 10,000 people, they have 3.
Oh my gosh.
And again, Singapore kind of sits in the middle to higher than middle, but the middle range there. And it's not just doctors that we're talking about. We're also looking at nurses too. Nurses are definitely carrying more responsibilities as you know, the more people are living longer lives and needing more services. The WHO said last month that the region, Asia Pacific region, needs roughly 1.9 million nurses by 2030 in order to fill the gap and make sure that nobody gets left behind. So that kind of gives you the extent of the situation. Now, it's not that we don't have healthcare workers. Actually, places like the Philippines and Indonesia are training a lot of people, but these people are often attracted by, you know, much higher salaries in the Middle East, in the United States, in the UK, and that often creates a brain drain for the healthcare systems that they're leaving. And with all of these things kind of put together, if we connect the dots, limited resources mean that there are healthcare professionals are forced to be more creative in order to meet the increasing needs of their patients, and there are many more of them. And also in limited resource settings, we have people like migrant workers, people who are on low income, who are poor, or other traditionally marginalized groups whose health is often just left behind. So this kind of paints a picture of what our conversation today that we're stepping into.
And, you know, I think that's some really confronting statistics, right? And I think for us here in Singapore, we've always prided ourselves, right, on great sort of healthcare and everything. But I think this whole situation where our migrant worker communities were so severely and disproportionately affected has really, I think, sent all of us really thinking very hard. So today we're really excited because we've got so many wonderful guests joining us from all over the world. We have one of my mother's students, actually. I'm so excited to reconnect with her. And she is a psychologist here in Singapore. And we also have a good friend of mine, and he's also a fellow performer and singer, and he's from Sing Theatre. And one of the reasons I thought of TJ is because they do this wonderful thing every year where they take music and the gift of music into hospitals. I thought he would have a special and unique perspective about this episode as well.
We'll also be hearing from a healthcare volunteer who's been delivering PPEs and shuttling healthcare workers in Manila while the Philippine capital is under lockdown, and also speaking to a healthcare advocate, a veteran age activist, and a good friend of mine who has keen insights on who traditionally gets left behind in health crises and what we can do.
But for now, very happy to say hello to Dr. Kim Lian Rolles-Abraham. She's a clinical psychologist here in Singapore. Welcome to the show, Kim.
Thank you for having me.
So one of the reasons I thought of chatting with you is because I remember, first of all, I'm just in awe of the fact that you have three gorgeous little girls under the age of three. So managing motherhood, and you're like a fresh mom too. You just delivered your baby 6 weeks ago, and you've got two other little toddlers. And you also have a thriving practice as a clinical psychologist. And what caught my eye was when this whole lockdown happened, you had written a really impassioned note on Facebook about the importance of mental health here in Singapore, and that, you know, that you guys have had to sort of be sort of lumped under the non-essentials category, and you were lobbying and sort of at least bringing awareness to the fact that I think more than ever, this period of time has been really challenging for people. So perhaps you could give us a little, and of course, I think because of the fact that so many of your colleagues and yourself as well spoke out, that the Ministry of Health actually revoked that and allowed for the mental health of Singaporeans to be looked after a little better. So perhaps you could tell us what's been that like for you.
Well, I guess it's been a bit of a bumpy journey with the different rulings about, you know, what is essential and what's non-essential. I do think that the main focus, I mean, what was at the forefront initially, obviously, was the coronavirus and how it affects people on a physical level, because I think, you know, that was the most, the way it manifested, right? And I think that obviously at that point in time, all the resources went to the medical aspect of things, which is well and good. And I think it was only a little bit later on that perhaps people started to realize that, you know, this thing was evolving and it wasn't going to go away. And so with that in mind, you know, there would be a lot of other challenges along the way, which would really impact one psyche. So I guess, I mean, I don't know what the process was like in terms of them deciding to reclassify psychological services as essential, but that has been great for myself and for my colleagues. We're still doing it in a little bit of a limited fashion, though, because we are only allowed to go in to the office for face-to-face consults for about four hours or so, 5 days a week. So that means no more than four clients, because one session takes about an hour. Mm-hmm. And so the rest of it, then we work from home remotely. We do either Skype or Zoom or whatever platform that is the most comfortable for us and our clients. So I think what we've had to do really is also come up with a bit of a triage system, you know, to look at where the greatest needs are. And it sounds really horrible to say that, to kind of say, okay, so you're worse off than the other and therefore you get face to face. And, you know, it's not something that we enjoy, but it's necessary. And so we've started seeing only the new cases face-to-face, because obviously, you know, when you meet a person for the first time, you don't want to do it over the online platform, because there are things that you would need to assess, risks and all of that. And then the other category that we see face-to-face would be those that are they pose risk either to themselves or to others, typically those that present quite a high suicidal risk. We would see them face to face.
And I mean, in this last month or so, I mean, what have you noticed with your patients, new and existing, that's sort of really presenting for them, you know, in their ability to kind of cope with this whole pandemic situation?
Wow, I think really this is commonly talked about in all of our sessions. You know, it comes a little bit more to the forefront instead of maybe some of the other issues that we were working on therapeutically before. You know, very often when I document my case notes, it often starts with patient shared that the circuit breaker brought out feelings of da da da. So it's almost as if it's the, you know, it's the one thing that everybody talks about immediately, and you know they have been also affected in various ways. I think the common one is being isolated. Because I think for a lot of my patients who already struggle with mental health issues, just that in itself is isolating. You know, the fact that perhaps other people don't understand what they're going through is isolating. And now we've put an extra layer to that isolation, which is the physical. You know, they don't get to connect on a physical level with other people. And so, and not everybody connects well through text or, you know, through Zoom or whatnot. In fact, I'm not even great with it. I only use Zoom when people give me a link and then I click on it. If you ask me to host a meeting, I still don't know how to do that. So, you know, I can only imagine how difficult it is for some of these people. Also, the level of suffocation, you know, emotionally, being surrounded by family. Well, I think for some people it's brought joy, but for others, especially the ones that I work with, because they already experience mental health issues and then that rubs off on the family and vice versa, it's very stifling, and they've found a real lack of privacy as well. And the routine has really shifted up for them, and a lot of my patients as well, you know, they can be quite rigid or quite fixed in their ways, and what has previously kind of given them comfort or solace has been a routine, you know, doing something that brings them comfort each day. And some of them, their coping mechanisms were to go out, to meet with people, to sit at a coffee shop and just people watch, just to do some window shopping. That has been their reprieve. But now they're stuck at home. And I think for a lot of mothers as well, being stuck at home also then comes with the obligation that if you're at home, then you got to manage the kids. Whereas previously, they would take a break by going out. And then if you're physically out, then that responsibility, that obligation is not there.
Yeah. Oh, that's so heartbreaking to hear. And I just feel like, you know, I think when you're more than anything, like we just recorded an episode before about food, right? And I think food and health, these are the most fundamental and essentials that come really much to the forefront when we're dealing with a worldwide pandemic that, you know, oftentimes it's so easy to get lost in things. But when you look at what is the daily reality for so many people, then you really sort of, yeah, you just sort of jolted into this sort of existential crisis almost, right? Everyone, like we were just talking about this with friends. So yeah, thank you for sharing, you know, Kim.
I think just the greatest thing at this point in time that people struggle with is uncertainty.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just, you know, when will things lift? When will things get back to normal? Will things get back to normal?
Yeah.
What is the new normal? So
thank you, Kim. I think that's a question we're all hanging on to right now, and so I want to just ask you to stay on the line. At this stage, I want to open the line to Manila and invite Tesa Celdran to the conversation. How are you, Tesa?
Good. A little bit. It's a rainy, stormy day in Manila today.
So
I love that she's sitting in her car.
I was dropping off somebody at the hospital, so I had to find somewhere to park in order to do this.
Right. Okay. So just to help our audience understand, what was life like for you before the pandemic, before all the lockdown measures in Manila? Because also Manila, the Philippines has had one of the longest lockdown situations in the region. So I'm just curious, what was happening for you prior to all of this?
Well, prior to that, personally, I was moving apartments. So I had to, you know, pack up and get things started moving. It was, the plan was really to move by March. So it was a big thing for me. Well, I'm also just trying to get together. I run the living room, which is like a creative space. So that again, I was trying to get the plans for the last quarter of last year, for the first quarter of this year going. And then here we are.
The living room is a place where artists visiting the Philippines can stay and have a bit of a short-term residence before moving to other parts of the country. Or is that right?
Yeah, we were trying to figure out the next steps, you know. So, yeah, that's what I... And how it's changed, I think it's...
Yes, that's right. So what are you doing now? Because most of the country's locked down and staying at home, but you're in a car in a car park.
Because I... Well, personally, I've always been a volunteer for something. You know, it started 20 years ago as warranting for Heritage Conservation Society. So it's something that I just do. But with the advent of social media, it just became a big thing. Everybody was doing something for a typhoon. Something was doing something for people needed help. So the service for that has been really good. So networks were in place. So I did that less and less and less and less. And then when lockdown happened, suddenly nobody knew what to do because there's no transportation. There's no, how do you get from point A to point B? And lucky for me, I'm part of a volunteer network. And they said, we just need volunteers. What can you do? I said, well, I have a car. We need to bring things to people. So they said, okay. So we started getting together. We were first transporting healthcare workers from hospitals to where they were staying. And then medical equipment from food to healthcare workers, personal protective equipment, face shields. So that's what I'm doing now. I'm really active because not a lot of us have cars.
Right. So you're delivering PPEs to hospitals, is that right? And having to pick it up from where? So like, are these private donations? I mean, I've been seeing pictures about deliveries and things like that coming to the Philippines. But I mean, why is there the need for people like yourself to do these deliveries when there should be like government services actually taking care of business?
And I don't think there are plans in place of what to do, because to be able to go on the roads, you'll need permits to do this, permits to do that. And since I'm with a volunteer group that already is connected, they were able to secure permits and said, we just need to be able to transport people. And so that was done quite easily. All I did is I'm signing up, I'm doing this, and they gave me an ID. I have like 3 IDs to be able to pass on, because we have checkpoints still. So it's not easy still.
Those are police checkpoints?
Police checkpoints, and also when you borders from one city to another.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's we have the barangay system, the police checkpoint. So it's about 3 layers of security, really.
Right.
And just to be able to do that. So we have people who gather the equipment we need, like the equipment, the face shields, the face masks. I pick them up from wherever they are in the city. Mm-hmm. It could be an apartment, it could be a home, it could be a church that's donating. Mm-hmm. And we're all... they're sent to hospitals. So we are connected to about 60 hospitals.
And you also mentioned what was news to me was that you're also shuttling people to and from work.
I'm here today because somebody needs a checkup because she's a cancer patient. Mm-hmm. So she has a checkup scheduled here in the hospital near here.
Okay. So I transported. Oh, so it's patients and also workers.
Yes.
So what have been some of the stories that you've heard? I mean, without giving any identifiable information or names or anything like that, but what are... I imagine you're as a driver, now you're also turning into a bit of a listening ear and a counselor for people as you're ferrying people across the city. What are some of the things that you're hearing?
One of the most touching stories I remember was it was a hospital called Fedel, a bit far off in Quezon City. It's a bit far. And I was just delivering just the face shields, that are about 300 face shields for them. And this doctor comes out. And then I just asked her I usually say, how are you and how's your family? First thing I ask, you know. And then she looked at me and she said, I'm fine. And then when I mentioned family, she started to tear up and cry. And I said, oh, no. I said, are you, you know, and I, you're not supposed to be touching each other, but we were both wearing gloves. So I just held her hands. And she said, I have an 11-year-old daughter, is what she said, who I haven't seen for months. And although she's with her mother, she knows she's safe, but things like this, like video conferencing, is just not enough for her. And she was really in tears. So mm-hmm. I just said, you know, we're here, even if we don't know each other. You understand, I'm trying to, you know, understand what you're going through, what we're going through as well. But we're here. So I just held her and didn't say anything for a couple of minutes. And then she said, I'm all right now. So just things like that. Because you know, it's, they have to be, what I realized, they have to be like that for their patients. Mm. They have to be brave, they have to be strong, and they have to show that they're not feeling any of these. Mm. But moments like that, when you're giving something to them and you just ask them how they are, makes a big difference.
And how are you holding up? I mean, you're seeing so many different things. I'm sure that also dealing with checkpoints and police can also be kind of tense in the current situation in Manila. How are you holding up yourself?
I go home and I eat some ice cream. No, but it's, you know, I get support I also get, because what I'm doing is purely volunteer. I get nothing. So I've had my friends calling me up. I go home and they said, we were sending you food so you don't have to have to cook your dinner. You know, we're sending you a bunch of PPEs. We're sending you, one time I received a cake. I said, whoa, I live by myself. It's a cake. I'm going to get fat. Never mind. It's just things like that. And the people are calling me and saying, are you, and it's, what's funny is that people are so scared for you. But when you're out there, it's not so scary.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah.
So I said, you know, to always be safe. I said, yeah, I know I could get sick, but so far I've been okay. But things like that, the care and the love and the support you get from just saying that you're volunteering is wonderful. So you need the support for those who also give the support. We all need that.
Thank you, Tessa, for your inspiring story. It was really just heartening, so heartening to, number one, reconnect with you, but also just to hear the work that you're doing there. So please stay on the line. It's a pleasure for me now to bring Karyn Kaplan on the line from New York to join us. How are you, Karyn? Welcome.
Hi, Laurindo and everyone. It's wonderful to be here. Even though it's midnight here and in the afternoon there, I'm used to it because all of Asia Catalyst's work is in Asia, and I'm regularly on calls like this. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Can you give our listeners a bit of an insight into what Asia Catalyst does? You are the executive director, am I right?
Absolutely, yes. I've been with the organization for 4 years. I've lived in Asia for about 25 years in Thailand. Always working in the HIV context, Asia Catalyst really was born out of the HIV epidemic in China specifically about 15 years ago, and there was a lot of discrimination happening, like everywhere. People living with HIV were being denied care at hospitals. They were being shunned from their families. And so there was a need for people to come together and figure out how to respond. And I think, you know, what's been so extraordinary about the response from directly affected people by HIV has been this kind of resilience that's been built up over the years, the communities, the strategies to, you know, build political will to respond effectively and humanely and using a human rights-based approach to the HIV epidemic. I feel like it's been very relevant as we're all confronting COVID-19. For example, right now we support, mainly what my organization does is training on human rights documentation and advocacy, so communities can respond to their own issues that are priorities for them, mainly barriers to accessing healthcare, using the tools of human rights and at the local level or national level or international level. And so, you know, it's largely already very marginalized and disproportionately affected people like transgender people or LGBTQI people, people who use drugs, transgender sex workers, undocumented migrants. And all of those communities over the years, we have worked together to build very strong networks that are able to quickly respond to urgent needs. So for example, some of what we do apart from training is sub-granting. So very small grassroots unregistered groups have access to resources, which is really crucial. And, it's very hard to get a grant for food. People are like, what does that have to do with access to healthcare? But, you know, right now, for example, sex workers, especially transgender sex workers in Thailand that, who we work with, have, you know, no income because sex work is radically affected by the, you know, lockdown and restrictions on movement, or undocumented Myanmar workers in Thailand who could not get back into their country. So we're supporting a group that works with those largely women, but women and men who are stuck in Thailand. So yeah, the HIV epidemic has a lot of lessons around, you know, building political will, community-led responses, overcoming, you know, stigma and discrimination, because a lot of what we're seeing, whether it's New York or, you know, Cambodia, is a lot of ignorance and fear driving policies, lack of information, and a lack of strong political leadership to do the right thing and not overreach in terms of rights violations. So I feel like it's been amazing to see how innovative a lot of these grassroots groups are, because they have so much experience working with very few resources, but, you know, a lot of ideas and a lot of connections and allies, which are essential. And so that's been the heartening side of all of this.
I remember meeting you many years ago when I was a newbie in AIDS activism. And while COVID-19 is a different virus, you must have a sense of deja vu coming from the AIDS movement. And then you see reports about who is most vulnerable in 2020 to a virus that has no cure. I mean, you hear the statistics from the States about how African Americans, recent migrants, people working in the informal sector are most vulnerable. In Singapore, you hear stories of how, you know, the population of migrant workers here, very little information about transgender communities, other communities are generally left under the radar. These are the same groups that you, I'm sure, we're talking about when we're trying to get more access to treatment and prevention for HIV, sex workers, people who use drugs, people who are in the prison system as well. Surely there must be some frustration going, well, this is happening again and we didn't get it fixed last time and here we are. Look. Didn't you see? I told you so. I mean, what must be going through your mind?
Yes, these social justice movements are definitely, we're in for the long haul, right? We're trying to address the kind of underlying drivers of these epidemics. And of course, we're only as strong as our most vulnerable as a global community. And right now, there feels like there's a lot of disunity. But at the same time, I think that's where we're seeing also some really bright spots in terms of responding to the challenge of this epidemic that can have potentially positive impact on the communities that we're talking about, whether they're transgender people, people in prison, people in closed settings, sex workers. Because what you're seeing, for example, I don't know if you guys have seen in the past couple of days, some very exciting things have been coming out of statements by UN agencies about the need to, for example, decriminalize sex work, decriminalize homosexuality, release people from prisons, you know, because they're seeing all of these criminalization and over-criminalization, overly restricting and cracking down on people for who they are, is actually undermining the response. And it's also just antithetical to respecting human rights. And so if we can use COVID-19 as an opportunity, in spite of all the sickness and all of the death and all of the horror, but it's still pointing to our vulnerabilities as a society, and we can hone in on those and say, okay, what haven't we gotten right so far? You know, whether you're talking about Rohingya refugees in Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh, or you're talking about elderly people in a nursing home in New York, you know, who are we not, you know, what happened there? What can we prevent? What can we take care of? And so the next epidemic won't be so horrible, but we're definitely in this for the long haul. And if it's going to expose some of these opportunities to correct, you know, racism, poverty, social exclusion, and criminalization of certain populations, and we can figure out the answers to those by finding more and more allies, then I think that will be a silver lining, and that I know a lot of us are prepared to work on.
Yeah, I mean, have there been any, have you seen any instances in the region, and we deal with a very big region in the Asia Pacific area, who have heeded that call from the UN agencies to, invest more, take care of the health of vulnerable communities? Have you got any reason for us to be hopeful and to see there to be movement than what had previously been done?
Absolutely. When I think back to the HIV epidemic in Asia, of course, in Thailand, they issued compulsory licenses to make sure that they could get access to affordable generic drugs. And a lot of countries in Asia and elsewhere did that. Right now, we're all thinking about the COVID-19 vaccine. Mm. How are, poor countries, low and middle income countries, going to get access, no matter where in the world we're talking about? And so a lot of countries have come out under the World Health Organization, about 150 world leaders from Pakistan to New Zealand, talking about how any drugs and diagnostics must be free to all who need it. We can't leave anyone behind. And it's the same idea that within the UN human rights mechanisms, there are things that allow us to prioritize life over profit. At some point, the market response is not going to work, and we have to take a rights-based response. And again, that was a lesson from the HIV epidemic. And I think countries like Thailand, Malaysia, Brazil, we're all having the political will because of activism to respond to their epidemics, but then needed additional tools to be able to do that because they weren't producing their own drugs and relied on, international pharmaceutical companies, but did indeed have the laws in place or put them in place where they needed to. And the same thing could happen with COVID. We could decriminalize sex work. We could decriminalize homosexuality. We could ensure more people have access to healthcare equitably. And we could rely on communities to solve the problems of their own communities and be seen as part of, health system strengthening, but we have to strengthen those communities to be able to be part of the health systems. And I think we see some of the most exciting advances in Asia, where we have a lot of organized, Asia Pacific network of people living with HIV, lots of networks of the groups that were disproportionately affected. And so that's what gives me hope.
It will be interesting to see how we're dealing with COVID-related stigma moving forward. All of these conversations about who's positive, who's negative, who is immune, who's not immune, when there's further data available. I think we've got a lot of lessons learned from the AIDS movement there. Karyn, I just have one more question. On every show, we invite our experts to imagine that they've been magically granted the power to change and reshape the way that things are done. And so, Karyn, if you were given the power to make changes to Asia's health system to make it more inclusive in the wake of COVID-19, what would be the top three things that you would do?
As an American, where we have one of the worst healthcare systems, for so many years living in Thailand under universal healthcare, which people living with HIV had a very large part in promoting in the early years. So I would say, the things that we all need, no matter where we're from, universal healthcare, affordable healthcare, equitable healthcare, universal basic income, removing any barrier to healthcare for whomever, whether you're, I work a lot also on TB, elderly women are, get diagnosed less than many other people for all the different reasons. They're in the home, cultural reasons. They deprioritize their healthcare compared to other people in the family. Looking at gender equality, things like that, just the basic stuff, poverty, gender inequality, and making all of those disappear with the snap of a finger.
Yeah, I love that. Thank you so much, Karyn. It was so insightful listening to you and hearing your contributions and all that amazing work you've been doing. Next, I'd like to introduce to the conversation Mr. TJ Taylor. He's the musical director at Sing Theatre here in Singapore, which is a local theatre company. And they do wonderful musical reviews and shows. And they, and of course, being in a theatre company, we've had to take a bit of a break.
A little bit of a break, yes.
Yeah, a bit of a break. But I think you've also been, apart from showing some of the shows that you guys have done online, you're also offering your classes, continuing on your with your musical theatre classes online, right? But tell us maybe just in terms of your initial response to everything you've heard at the moment, and also maybe thinking about Sing Theatre's usual sort of yearly outreach in your work in the hospitals. Like what, how are you feeling about all of this?
Well, first of all, obviously, I think this situation, it's so unprecedented. And I think for especially those of us in the arts, it is something that for us, it is a necessary thing for us to step back, because most of our work involves bringing people together. And at this time, that just simply can't happen in person. But what's been most inspiring for me is how, as an artist community, people have innovated their work. And a lot of theatre, for example, that I spend most of my time in is live and it involves connecting with people and working directly with people. But what's been fantastic to see, and myself as a practitioner as well, we've had to think outside the box. We've had to think, how can we still bring these events and these moments and still bring people together through music, through theatre, through dance, in innovative ways that as practitioners, we never thought we would ever have to do. Like, we don't train as performers to perform through Zoom or to an online play. That's not what we do. But in this time when people simply can't get together, we still do need to come together. And I think it's been wonderful that platforms like Zoom and Skype and those sort of things are able, we're at that point now in society where when technology, that we're able to actually do these things and bring things together and put things on online. So the arts is still alive. It's just in a very different way, but also it's a very challenging way for artists, because for artists to survive, it's very hard to kind of sustain an income and things like that. But it is a necessary moment in time where it's a hit that we have to take, because the health is so important right now. But the artist community overall is always resilient and will always try and give back. And I think that's the main thing, that sharing, like whether people are getting paid or whether it's just majority of people are just giving their time and volunteering in that way, is just absolutely fantastic to see. So that's been truly inspiring. And that's from around the world, like Singaporean artists. I've seen that in the UK. Actually, all the artist communities around the world, the things that people have been sharing has really been amazing to bring people together online. And I think people who can access that are really taking it as a source of comfort in very uncertain times. In terms of Sing Theatre, so I work for a theatre company here called Sing Theatre, which was set up by a fabulous lady called Natalie Rebett about 15 years ago. And Natalie initially started the company to bring French culture to Singapore and promote French culture through that. But over time, she kind of found a need to kind of give back to the community in some other way. And she found that need in hospitals because hospitals can be a very... obviously clinical environment, and for good reasons. But by bringing music to hospitals, Natalie found an area where we can kind of give back as artists. We can give back to the community, because when you're in the hospital and when you're going through some of the toughest times of your life, everyone's there for different reasons. Music can be such a reprise and an uplifting moment in somebody's day. So since 2013. As an organization, we've been going into different hospitals around Singapore, specifically Sing Health hospitals at the moment, and organizing different music projects to like some performances in the lobbies, also taking performances to the bedsides, bringing some of the top artists in Singapore, like Ho San Leong's performed there. We even had Kumar, one of our performances I think last year. So we've had lots of different performers come to the hospital just to kind of kind of have that escapism from their situation. And I think, you know, we were talking about mental health earlier, and I think music is one of those things that can really kind of help with people's mental health. And I think that's the same for us, whether we're in hospital or not right now, to kind of take us away from the situation. So we've been spending quite a lot of time on that, creating lots of different projects over the last few years. But obviously with the situation, we've not been able to take artists to the hospitals for obvious reasons with transmission and things like that. So for us as an organization, it's been the last few weeks of spending, how do we still provide this service? How do we still bring music to hospitals in a meaningful way? And it's obviously not been the priority for hospitals right now. You know, they've been dealing with the crisis, but actually as the crisis is kind of evolving, actually we're having more conversations with the hospitals, and they're seeking some respite specifically for the nurses and the doctors, actually, because that's the other side to what we do, because of course we do the patients, but we do a program called Sing Me a Story, where we dress as superheroes and villains and go and sing to the children's wards, and I used to dress in my underpants as Captain Singapore I had other clothes than I promised. So we used to go around the children's wards and sing songs. And actually, the beautiful thing, obviously the kids engaged and it was all for the kids, but the smiles on the nurses and the doctors' face when we used to come into the wards and kind of just take the nurses and doctors who have very stressful jobs day to day, they would have a little smile and a little laugh and a joke as we came through. And you could tell that it impacted their day in a very meaningful way. So our focus right now is, how do we bring those programs online, certainly for the, so, you know, for the foreseeable future, to still give those doctors and nurses, especially, that kind of escapism in their lunchtime. So that's our big focus at the moment.
Oh, that's wonderful to hear, TJ. I hope you manage to get that going. And I guess before you sing us your special song, maybe we'll go around to all our guests to just sort of give us your little sort of wrap up. And maybe we'll start with you, Karyn. What would you like our listeners to know?
I guess just back to your point earlier about the boats, we're all in this together, maybe in different boats, but if we can keep finding the connections that bring us together more than the disunity that a lot of the political leaders seem to be sowing, I think that's the message, because I really, truly have seen the most marginalized communities transcend their situations, help keep each other alive simply through forming community. And I think that with COVID as a global community, we can do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Karyn. How about you, Tessa?
You know, I always used to think of volunteering, always giving in a big way. But now that I'm, you know, we need to be distanced, I do things in a very small way. It's just me picking up stuff. So I guess what I'm saying is every small bit helps. You know, no matter how small it is, it matters. Yeah. And it doesn't have to be giving in a big way or giving big donations, but just saying, how are you and how's your family is also a way of giving. So we need all of that right now. It's very important, I think.
Thanks for that. And how about you, Kim?
Well, just three small points. First one, stay connected as you can. It's really the most important thing now. Secondly, look out for those that may not have the resources, whether it is food during this time, whether it is company during this time in terms of texting or online platforms, and also to help some of those people set some of these things up, like some of the elderly who may not know how to use certain things to get connected. Look out for them. And lastly, stop trolling the news. you know, seriously, pick a couple of accurate sources, look at those and be done. Because at the end of the day, the more we read, and you know, some articles can get quite depressing. Okay, coronavirus is never going to go away. This is never going to happen. Da, da, da. So, you know, let's just keep to the basics, things that will help you to understand what you need to do for yourself and for those around you.
Yeah, wonderful. I love that. Thank you all so much for your advice and your offerings and your sharing. I guess, I mean, I've learned also, I don't know about you, Laurindo, but you know, it's almost like you're the editor of your life and you're curating your content, right? And you want to be drawing some boundaries. It's like, what's your magazine about? So what are you about, right? And if that does not fit in this magazine, this does not exist. So just X that, just, you know, unfriend or undo and unfollow and just, I know it kind of, I was like, okay, this is my own little echo chamber, but I think I'm okay for now, for here, right? And occasionally, I think, exactly, drawing those boundaries. But also, I think that's why I love these conversations and that we get to dip in and to hear, you know, perspectives from different people from all over in all sectors, right? So anything you want to add, Laurindo, before we...
I just want to thank all of our guests again, to Kim, to Tessa, to Karyn, to TJ. Thank you so much for your time. I want to let our listeners know that if you'd like more information about the people who've joined us today and their work, make sure to check out the Inclusively website for details. We'll be providing links to everyone. Please also remember to like this podcast and submit a review. Your feedback will help us improve, and it's certainly most welcome. And don't forget to sign up on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and also YouTube, so then you're notified of when a new episode is out.
Wonderful. So before we go, we'd just like to say thank you for listening. And TJ, what special song have you got for us today?
Well, I chose this song, actually, because we focus on musical theatre over at Sing Theatre, and this is one of the most classic musical theatre songs of all time, but it also has another meaning, especially over in the UK. A symbol of kind of support for this crisis has become the rainbow. Many people are putting rainbows up in their windows and things like that. So I thought it was very fitting for this time, and it's a song about hope. So I'm going to sing you Somewhere Over the Rainbow from Wizard of Oz.
Yay! All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's please enjoy Mr. TJ Taylor with Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
When all the world is a hopeless jumble and the raindrops tumble all around, heaven opens a magic lane. When all the clouds darken up the skyway, there's a rainbow highway to be found, leading from my windowpane to a place behind the sun, just a step beyond the up high, there's a land that I've heard of once in a lullaby. Somewhere over the rainbow skies are blue, and dare to dream really do come true. Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me, so the troubles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops. That's where you'll find. Beyond the rainbow, why?